Boa tarde para quem está chegando. Or should I say welcome? Good afternoon. Marlene, bem-vinda. Opa, bem-vindo, pessoal. Já estou aqui com o meu pomar. Bem-vindos, welcome. Buenas tardes, es Madrid. Bonjour. Sejam bem-vindos, welcome. Opa, vinho de corte, tudo bem, gente? Glaucia, bem-vinda. Arthur. Boa tarde, Daniel. Estamos aguardando o Frederico entrar. Alguém está servido? Pomar 2013. Eu sei que aparece como no espelho, né? Mas para quem não conseguir ler, é um pomar 2013 que está sendo usado para Fer Labouche. Bom, se alguém puder avisar lá o Frederic, que estamos aqui aguardando, Gláucia ou Raíssa. Tá servido, Daniel? Tá bom, viu? Novo, nervoso. Boa tarde, Fernando. Opa, Adão, bem-vindo. Tá um quórum bom, hein? O horário eu sei que não é dos melhores. Obrigado, pessoal aí. Estamos aqui aguardando o Frederico chegar. Meu amigo Zé Maria Santana. Como eu disse, estamos aqui aguardando o Frederic. A live vai ser em inglês, tá? Me perguntaram aqui. Infelizmente é difícil o estrangeiro falar europeu falar português, exceto Portugal, claro. Então vamos usar o inglês. Para quem não sabe, a Maison Jadot ganhou ontem, eu soube ontem, ganharam um prêmio importante que é o HVE, High Environmental Value, que seria algo próximo ao orgânico, entendeu? Mais ligado à sustentabilidade. Ele vai explicar melhor um pouquinho, eu vou perguntar a ele. Joaquim Alessi, bem-vindo. Estamos, como eu disse, aguardando aqui o Frederic. Sérgio, Elias, Joaquim, Val. Hi, Frederic. You should send an invitation. Okay? You should send a request to get in the live. I cannot accept you unless you do this request, okay? If you don't see this option, you should go out and in again. And then you see this possibility to send me a request to get in the live. Ele tá. Glaucio, o Frederico não mandou o pedido para entrar. Espera aí, deixa eu ver aqui. Já adicionei o Frederico, estou aguardando, tá, gente?
Yes.
Yes! Thank you, we did it. Welcome, Frederico. Thank you. Took a few minutes. No, no problem, no
Sorry,
problem. We
that's
have very good people here watching, many professionals, many journalists, so a high-level audience. Thank you very much. Welcome. My friends, this is Frederic Barnier, Technical Director of Maison Jadot. Frederic, as I read, you're celebrating 10 years of Jadot, right? You started in 2010. So, compliments. And I just told
Yes,
the guy
correct.
here.
10 years.
Okay,
2010
okay.
was my vintage.
And I was just telling the audience that Maison Jadot just yesterday
13 is my
got
official
a new
start vintage. Yes.
certification, HVE, High Environmental Value. Can you tell us what's that?
Yeah, it's a French certification about the way we are farming our vineyard. It's something to make sure that you protect the biodiversity. You are using less as possible, the chemicals to spread the leaves, the vine plants. That you respect, of course, the water, the rivers, the everything which is living around our vineyards. So that's of course a first step, because for the vintage 2020, we are working to get the organic certification, organic farming. So we are on this big project for us, because it's something which is difficult, a challenge, especially in Burgundy, because of the size of our domain, but also because of the weather we have in Burgundy, which sometimes doesn't help us to, I would say, to be confident day after day. Sometimes we are not sleeping so well. We have many things, to resist many diseases sometimes. So it's still a challenge to farm, the organic way. On the paper, it seems to be easy, but here in Burgundy, it's not so easy. So, just to give you an idea, only 10% of the area in Burgundy is farmed officially in organic. So it's just to give gives an idea of I would say the big challenge we have in Burgundy. We are on the way because that's a necessity. We know it very well, but again, from a vintage to another vintage, the conditions we have, the weather we have, the diversity of the vineyards we have, it's a challenge. But we are on the good way.
By UNESCO, the soil, the subsoil of Burgundy is UNESCO heritage, right?
Yeah, it's more complex. It's the idea of the clima. Clima, in fact, it's the small names we have everywhere in Burgundy, which are a link with the soil. You what you said before, the subsoil, but not only, because what is protected in Burgundy, what is so special, it's what we are farming now. It's what have been made by people before us. So the human impact have made a part of what Burgundy is. I mean, if Clos Vougeot is where the Clos Vougeot is located today, it's because some monks have built some walls. And it's not only because the soil or the subsoil have a specificity which makes a Grand Cru. So there is a part of human decisions which have, drawn the vineyards we are farming now. And there is many mistakes in Burgundy, but in fact, it's probably what makes Burgundy so special.
Well,
because it's made by human, and we know
the monks and the history.
People are making mistakes sometimes, but it's
what the most fantastic, almost magical about Burgundy is that history, where the monks, especially from Citeaux and Benedictines, made in this area. And I visited this abbeys, and it's traveling in time, and it's a deep dive into terroir. Can you explain a little bit of this history to us?
Yeah, clearly, you know, Burgundy, we have few vineyards which are existing in Burgundy since 2000 years, because the first people we started to farm here in Burgundy are the Roman people. So, but clearly during the Middle Age, between the 7th, 8th centuries to the 12th centuries here, especially due to the people, the religious people, the monks, have clearly developed the vineyard, the farming, but not only the vine plants, but all the culture, the agriculture, but also, of course, especially here in Burgundy, the viticulture. And they have created a part of the business we know today. I told you just before I spoke a few words about the Clos Vougeot, but to give you an idea, the monks from the Clos Vougeot, they were selling the wines from Clos Vougeot to other people. So they have created a business. They were very clever because they had understood that the top part of the Clos Vougeot at that time was the greatest part. So it was the wine, you know, for the celebration. So they have kept this part. But all the other parts of the Clos Vougeot, where they were producing another great wines, but they were selling it to other people. So they have created the vineyards. They have designed the climate, the diversity of the Premier Cruz we know today. And also they have developed a part of the business. It was really the seed, the first seed of what we know now everywhere in the world. So the monks
have developed what Burgundy is today.
So it's really one of our heritage.
Wine lovers. They like
comes from there.
They like it to eat. They had lots of time to study the soil. And they had a fantastic network. They had the internet of the time. That it was the monasteries, the abbeys, through the whole Europe, so they could exchange information. That was fantastic. And many people said that the best wines they drank and they sold the others, the other wine, the rest of them.
Yeah, clearly, they already knew immediately where was the best areas, where were the best wines, Chambertin Claude Bèze, the Clos Saint-Jacques, the Clos Vougeot, the top vineyards. We know what people are dreaming about. they clearly it's the wines they were drinking because and because they had time. You know what you said before is important. They had a lot of time. Their work was to be really focused every day on the different places and to understand very well what was the good part of each vineyard. So this time, sometimes we don't have so much time now. It's crazy. We have so many things to do. But honestly, they had the time to develop, to understand very well what was exactly the top part, the different limits we have now.
So
they have made a big part of the job. It was an important moment for Burgundy. They understood
the vineyards and the hierarchy of the vineyards. How is that hierarchy today? I mean, Premier Cru, Grand Cru, can you explain to us?
Yeah, so in Burgundy, we are, well, I'm not sure that they have created the appellation, but they've understood that in Burgundy, we the place, the location makes the largest part of the quality of a wine, the specificity of a wine. I mean, in Burgundy, it's probably true as it's difficult to, I would say, to imagine that it exists elsewhere. In Burgundy, it's really one of our most important thing to understand our wines. It's to understand that here you can make a wine with a specific profile, and another place you will find something completely different. So we have a classification. We when you know where you are in the vineyard, when you know where the location is, you know in the classification of your wine. So it's a geographical classification. So we have the regional wines, like the Bourgogne Chardonnay, Bourgogne Pinot Noir, Mâcon Village, that's, I would say, the classic basic wines. It's 50% of what is produced in Burgundy. So it's the largest part of what is produced in Burgundy. Then you have the village wine, Meursault, Puligny, Montrachet, Pommard, Gevrey-Chambertin, Chambol-Musigny. It's around one-third of what is produced in Burgundy. And most of time, it's the vineyards are around each village. So you will find a small city, a small village of Meursault, and all the vineyards, all the wines produced around this village of Meursault have the name Meursault. And there is, of course, a third level, which is Premier Cru, because you have a selection of the top vineyards all around each of it. They have all a name, Meursault Charme, Meursault Genévrière, Meursault Perrière. It's really the vineyards which have something special. And again, the monks, we were talking about them before, they have understood that because they had time to divide each plot of vineyards and to know, okay, here, from here, we are doing better grapes, we are doing a better wine, so it has to be a special area. And today, it's the Premier Cru we know. And of course, in few villages, not everywhere in Burgundy, just in few places, in Gevrey-Chambertin, in Chambol-Musigny, in Chassagne-Montrachet, we have what we call Grand Cru. That's really a special list, the top of the top, the last, I would say, level on the pyramid of our classification. And that's the greatest wines we are producing. They are the greatest because from a vintage to another vintage, they are always top. So that's vineyards which are able to digest the difficulties from a difficult vintage. Yes, it could be a difficult vintage, a challenging vintage, but the wines are great. So that's why they are Grand Cru, because they have something that the other places, the other vineyards are not able to do. So
yeah,
difficult to explain because it's coming from the soil,
from
the subsoil.
And he told
we don't
me
know
that
exactly
Burgundy,
why,
but don't look to the sky, they look to the soil. And
we are looking through history to the sky also, especially the weeks
related
before the
to the nobility and the dukes, yeah. Napoleon, a lot of great characters from history liked Burgundy, especially Napoleon and Chambertin was a relationship, a famous relationship, by instance. And what is interesting also in Burgundy is that mainly, not only, but mainly two grades, one red, one white. Can you explain a little bit how that works? A whole region, hundreds of classified vineyards, different wines, and only one red, one white. Not only, but mainly one red and one red, white.
Yeah, you know, in fact, you have to be frank. In Burgundy, we have to be clear. We could farm probably everywhere, white or red, Chardonnay or Pinot Noir, and probably make an interesting wine. I mean, today, it's impossible to imagine Pinot Noir in Montrachet, which is at 100% white area. By law, it's not possible to produce a Montrachet red, but honestly, probably we could produce a very interesting wine also in the Montrachet. But of course, historically, what has been made before, again, it's what I told you before, people, they have been used to produce only white in few places. So now it's clearly, you know, written on a paper by rules in few areas, it's not possible to produce one color. But agronomically, honestly, why not? Look, Musigny, as you know, it's mostly red, but one guy has produced a white wine, and it's not ridiculous. It's a very interesting wine. So Burgundy is made for different reasons. We have agronomic reasons, we have the soil reasons, the production reasons, but again, we have decided sometimes to do exceptions. You know, the French exception, but here it's the Burgundian exception. It's not perfect. Probably, again, we could be able to produce interesting wine in few places on the opposite color. But no, we have decided it's like that because it's a tradition. It's coming from a very old time. Let's see, in 100 years, I don't know what will happen. Maybe we will do Gevrey-Chambertin white or Montrachet red, not sure, but you never know. But again, that's something which is like that because we have decided it. Of course, in other few places, it's possible to produce white and red, in Pernod-Vergelès, in Meursault, people, they don't know really.
Hello, I think I lost you for a few seconds and we are back. Okay, now let's start to talk a little bit about Maison Jadot. First, can you explain the difference of domain and Maison? Okay. Yes, you are domain and Maison.
I'm back.
Of course.
Okay. There is no difference. We are Louis Jadot. Mm-hmm. No, I mean, that's important. There is no difference. I mean, no difference for me because I'm doing the wines for both of you. It's historically, it's important to understand it. We are a negociant, a traditional negociant. It means that our story is the fact that we started in buying some grapes, few land, but now, for different reasons, we are an important farmers. So you have what we are farming, etc.
Mm-hmm.
And you have also what we are buying from partnership from friends, because some of it we are buying few grapes since 30 years, 40 years, 50 years. So it's Maison Louis Jadot. But all the grapes, are made in
Okay, so just
are
explain to
macerating in
people.
the same
Usually,
facility,
you
in the
own
same
vineyard,
tanks, in the
and
same
Maison, you
barrels.
buy
The same team
grapes.
is
But Jadot
looking
has
to the
both.
wine.
Have
So
many
for me,
great
I
vineyards
never
and also buy some grapes.
do any
So we're
difference
talking about
between Maison
Jadot.
Mijado or Domaine Mijado.
Can
I'm
you tell
talking about Maison
us a
Mijado
little bit
in
of the
general,
history of
and
the company?
it's
When
the
did
same
you
box for me.
start?
The general history of the company. So, Mijado has been created in 1859 by a family from Belgium, arrived at the beginning of the 19th centuries. And Mr. Jadot get married with a lady who bring a piece of land, the Bonne Clos des Ursules, in 1826. It was really the first beginning of what I would say will become Maison Louis Jadot. So the company has been developed especially during just before the Second World War, because the Jadot family, they met the Kopf family, an American who were living in New York, and who have created a nice company of importation in US. So we have developed on the first way, on the first side, I would say, the production in buying some land, some grapes, but on the other side, in selling our wines in the US, which was clearly for us, I would say, a big boom. So we have developed the business strongly during the 50s, the 60s, the 70s, the 80s. And finally, just after the death of the last Jadot, we then the his wife has decided to sell the company to the Kopf family. So we are now I would say an American company, but in fact owned by really people who are we know very well the Jadot company, because from the beginning they are with us with the I would say the history. And of course we have on the same time the Gaget family, who are running the company since the third, so now it will, in fact, makes the third generation who is running the company. So we are really a family producer owned by a part of our earth in America and another part of our earth in Burgundy, of course. Today, it's what I explained, I told you before. It's a necessity to farm a lot and to own the land. Because on the same time, we have developed, I would say, what is Burgundy, as you know very, very well, the small growers now are very, very successful. So most of them, they are selling their wines by themselves. So a negotiant like us, we cannot get so much the grapes from the other growers. Now, if you want to have Montrachet, Bâtard, the Premier Cru, the top villages, you need to own the land and to farm it. So that's why we have developped the domain part, because today we are farming a large vineyard
Yeah, but
because it's
by
a necessity.
curiosity, I did a few months ago a
75%
tasting
of
of
what we are
Montrachet,
producing at the village
50
Premier Cru
different
Grand Cru
Montrachet from
level
50
is
different
coming
producers.
from our domain.
Amazing.
So we
So
are
many
clearly
producers
the
in a
biggest domain
very small
today
piece of
compared
land.
to
But you mentioned vineyards. How
negotiant part,
many
because
hectares do
that is the
Jadot have
way
today?
it's working now for producer like us. It's a necessity.
No, in Burgundy. Yeah, in general, in France.
In Montrachet or in general? In general. Yeah. So we are farming 135 hectares in Côte d'Or, and we have also 80 hectares in Beaujolais with the Château de Jacques, and around 20 hectares with Domaine
So
Ferret.
for people to understand,
So We are
size
farming
is big in
250 hectares,
Burgundy,
something
but
like
it's
that now
maybe medium in
in Burgundy.
Bordeaux, and it would be
But
very
of
small
course,
in Chimay.
you need to include what we are controlling because we have
And
many very good
I've been
contracts, good
visiting Jadot in
partnerships
Bonn. I've
with
been
who we
there.
are really controlling
I
the
was
quality
amazed
of
by
the grapes and of
the
course at the end
variety
the
and
wines.
quality of the wines. There are hundreds of barriques, and I tasted many, many barriques. And what I like most about Chardot is first, consistency. You have always a good wine.
That's true.
Independently of the vineyard or the vintage, you're trustable. And this in Burgundy has a great value because Burgundy is very irregular. To buy, I have a friend who usually used to say that a good Burgundy costs £100 in England because you have to buy 5 of £20 to find a good one. So to be a trustable producer in Burgundy is something with high value, and consistency, of course, and also availability. You find Jago. Other producers you don't find. It's hard to find. So compliments to the Maison. And I don't know if you want to start the tasting the wines now, but I have Pommard. I know it's mirrored, the image, but it's Pommard 13. If you can tell me a little bit about this wine.
So you are tasting Pommard?
Yeah.
Yeah, well, so yeah, so 13 is I love 13 because it's my first official vintage alone because I share 11, 10, and 12 vintage with Jacques Larder, my predecessor, and 13 was the first vintage for me, I would say, as the head winemaker in Jadot. But and 13 was a challenging vintage, very difficult farming season, and very long months of September to wait before to pick our grapes, and clearly a challenging vintage before to pick it. And finally, we have to say that we were really surprised by the quality of the wines. And I think it's one of the last vintage to show that in Burgundy, we don't need a perfect weather as most of time now we have outside. I mean, sunny, warm, with a great season. Sometimes the difficulties we could have outside, you don't have it in the glass. So it could, if I explain precisely what happened in 13, I won't. But if I do it, you will never trust me that it's possible to make a good wine. And in Burgundy, that's one of the rare places where it's possible. We need to suffer to make good wines in Burgundy. When it's too easy, it's something strange. But in Burgundy, we need to suffer a little bit. Because 13 was clearly surprising. I mean, there is a I'm not saying that it's the best vintage we have made. There is a, you feel the freshness, you feel the difficulties, you feel the vintage where the ripeness is not completely perfect. But there is something, the wines are approachable, which honestly, it's a surprise if you think about the tannins, the maturity, the grapes we had, and the difficulties we have during the season. So that's a vintage which is talking to me, 13. And Pommard,
Sorry. We
classic
are not in
village
Bordeaux,
from
right?
Côte de Beaune, quite rustic, but
I would say
with a
that
good
usually
power.
Pommard,
So
you
that's a very
expect
important
tannins.
village for us because we are
It's a more
producing a
male
significant
Burgundy.
number
Usually
of
Pommard,
barrels.
this one
Are
has
you,
tannins.
Marcello, we
Also,
say barrel,
freshness,
pièce,
good,
piece in Burgundy,
is
not
vibrant,
barrique.
young wine,
Barrique, it's from
and a
Bordeaux.
good aroma too. It's intense. It's at the same time seductive. And masculine with tannins and acidity. He's 13, still young, but it's quite drinkable now. Gastronomic, I would say, but quite drinkable. And about the wood, how many months in wood? How many months does this one?
13. Alors, oui. We do
Une
quite the
malolactic
same
tendal.
type of aging from the village wines to the Grand Cru, and to give you an idea, it's around one third of new oak barrel, one third of 1 year, one third of 2 years during 18 months, 16 to 18 months. So it has been aged around 18 months in oak, in barrels. In barrels, always. So we fill up the barrels immediately after the racking, after the maceration. We macerate the grapes around 3-4 weeks, and immediately after we rack the tank and we fill up the barrels to start the aging. So of course the malolactic fermentation takes place in barrels,
olha,
most of
aqui
time
da
next
Food,
spring, so few months
que os vinhos
after
têm promoção
the
no
harvest, of
site, viu?
Course, when the
Se não me engano,
temperature
40% de desconto. Sorry, sorry,
is a little
they
bit
were writing
cooler in our
to me
cellar,
from Interfood, Todovino,
but it depends on the
saying
vintage.
that the wines
It's never
are in
happening
promotion
when you
40%
want.
off
Malolactic
with
fermentation is
opportunity.
something you cannot control, so it's really difficult
And
sometimes.
let me drink this. I'm not speaking today. I have an early happy hour here. It's 5:30. Now I have Bon, L'Odeur Sud, 2011.
Here it's really the time to
this
drink.
Is
It's
I think it's a
not far to be
historical
9 o'clock
wine, right?
p.m. in France, so it's really the dinner time. So I drink. Yeah. Yeah, so it's really the first plot. When the Jadot family arrived in Burgundy, they have bought. So it's a plot which arrived, I would say, at that time when you get married, there is a gift from the lady. And the gift was a piece of land. So it is Bonne Premier Cru Clos des Ursules. So it was a nice gift. So that's really the first beginning of Maison Louis Jadot. It was not, I would say, to buy some grapes. It was to farm a land and to have this first plot, this first Bonne Premier Creuse. So it makes us, you know, a very attached to Bonne area, because that's our first vineyard. We were created in Bonne. We are located in Bonne. And Bonne today is a very important location for us because we have many Premier Crus in that area. And it's a fantastic appellation. People, they don't know so well Bonne. They know the city. You came in Bonne. You are eating in Bonne a lot. There is many, many restaurants. And when you are coming to Bonne, most of the time you are not drinking Bonne Premier Crus. That's a big mistake, because that's a great appellation. You are drinking Meursault, Puligny, Chambol-Musigny, but you don't see the vineyard behind the city. And it's, for me, one of the most underrated places in Burgundy, because the wines are diverse. Yeah, you can play with it. The wines are beautiful, very diverse. You could find very powerful wines with Les Boucherottes. You could find a very elegant wine with Les Terrons or with
Well,
Gras.
Don't you
here
think?
It's Clos des Ursules. It's
is
one of
my
the
dream
top
place
location
to
in
live.
Bonn.
When I
and
retire,
the potential
I'm going
of
to
aging is
buy a
huge.
house
I mean,
in Bonn or
10
in the
years,
region.
15 years, 20
When I
years,
was in
30 years, 40
Burgundy, I
years.
rented a
That's
place
not a
in
problem
Pouligny.
for Bonne Premier Creuse. So
I was in Pouligny
for the
for
price
some
of the
time,
Pomard village.
Just
so
beside
that's a great location to discover.
Domain there. Beautiful place. And then, as Frederic said, to buy is a very smart buy, because Bon Premier Cru, great, great, great map. Bon Premier Cru usually are cheaper, and some of them has the same quality of Bon Romanée, for example. I think so. In this case, I taste the wines is 2011, 9 years, but it's quite young. The acidity is high. It's electricity. It's like, switch electricity on 220 volts. The acidity is very high. It's too young, I think. Maybe I would keep this bottle. and drink the pomar.
You could. Now it's Clos des Ursules again. It's one of the greatest places in Beaune. From another vintage, which is on the paper, not the best one, because 11 was not so easy, especially because of the summer.
Someone
the summer
asking
time
about
was not
East,
perfect.
if you
But
use
again,
it's
a vintage after a few years of aging, as today. Like you are drinking now Tease 11 after few years
additives.
In aging in bottle. It's showing very, very well. So nice wine. Of course, indigenous. Of course. If we could stay at 100%. Yeah. You know, you have to know that the yeast, they are coming from the place where you are vinificating. Most of the people, there is many people who are thinking that the yeast are coming from the grapes, from the place, from the location. It's not true. The yeast, sometimes you could find some yeast, of course, around the berries, but this type of yeast, it's not what is making the fermentation in the tank. The yeast, which I would say start the vinification in your facility, in your winery, is the yeast you have on the walls, in the air, in your tanks. If you have oak tanks, for example, like us, you know, it's full of life. So it's what makes, I would say, the fermentation. And from a vintage to another vintage, it's not exactly the same mix which is making the fermentation. So that's the difficulty. It's sometimes it works, but you don't know exactly why. Sometimes it doesn't work in that tank or in that wine. So clearly the idea is to let, I would say, start the fermentation, what you say with indigène, but
okay.
Indigène it's from the I would say the
There's
yeast
another
you
question
have
here,
in your winery.
But I think it's very good.
But sometimes it doesn't work. So my target, my job is to make sure that
and
the fermentation Burgundy
say
finish.
Is the place
so if I have
in
to
the
do
world
something,
as a
I will.
Region that I
but
see
if I have nothing to do, I prefer. It's less work for me, it's
wood,
perfect. So that's the idea.
You are really specialized in how to match wine and wood for me. And people are asking, how do you select the barriques? How is the barrique selection?
We have our own cooperage, so it helps a little because we control really the process for the barrel making. So we have created our cooperage in 98, so end of the 90s. So we are buying the oak from different origins in France. From France, it's only French oak. We have a partner. His job is to farm some so the trees, the forest, and to cut and to choose, I would say, the best trees as possible. But it's a very complex part of the job because in one tree, in one oak, you have different types, different quality of oak. So it's not so easy to find a good oak. But we have a very good partner to help us for that. And we have our own cooperage where we are aging our oak during 24 to 30 months. So with the Burgundian weather, so it's in Ladouas-Sérigny, not so far from Beaune, at 5 kilometers far from here. And they are making the barrels for us. So we know exactly how the barrels are made. We know exactly where the trees are coming. We know exactly how it's, as you know, toasted, because we are burning a little the inside the barrels for to obtain the flavors, the nice toasted flavors we have in the wines. So that's a very big point, because when you
Yes.
age your wines 15, 18 months in barrels as we do, when you are using so many barrels as you have seen when you have visited us, you need to be very confident. If you are not sure of the quality of your oak, if you are not sure of your toast, if you are not sure of your cooperage, then it's a nightmare. You never sleep. So us, we control that very, very strictly, closely. So we are quite happy with what I would say we do today.
I should say that we really went to the peak of the mountain. This Chablis is fantastic. It's really enchanting in the nose. I didn't taste yet. So, Frederic, I think Chablis for me is a region more than in Ecuador, that the difference between the basic, the premier, and the Grand Cru are even easier to see. But just not, do you agree?
Yeah, you know, it's an area where I would say the classification, a part of the classification is quite new. So there is, of course, the heart of Chablis, the top names, the Grand Cru's names, the Fourchaume, the Montée de Tonnerre, a part of the Premier Cru's, which are, I would say, very famous. But another part of Chablis is quite new. So I think it's probably today it's... there is a lack of notoriety, a lack of knowledge about Chablis, and people are not so used with so many names because most of the small premier crus are most of time sold, you know, in a premier cru, in a blend, or a part in Chablis village. So it's in a certain way, it's a young place in Burgundy, but very interesting place because, of course, it's a large region, and especially for us, we were not very present a few decades in past in Chablis. It was not, I would say, a place where we were so good. We were more, I would say, used to Beaujolais, to Mâconnais, to Côte d'Or, of course, but Chablis, the Chablis region for Chablis is not so new, but
for me. I'm listening
a little
you
bit
perfectly.
New. We are probably better today in Chablis as what we were in 10 years or 15 years or 20 years because we are not so involved as what we are now in Chablis.